This program features live coverage of an African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised. This program features live coverage of an African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
Good morning to a very chilly day in the African bush. We are looking at a group of impala, and this is definitely Safari Live. Hello and welcome again. It is very cloudy here on Juma Private Game Reserve. My name is Taylor, and on camera this morning I've got Viam. Good morning, Viam. Now, I'm sure if most of you were watching the dam cam, you would have seen some lions, and that's what we are going to be following up on this morning. So we're going to do a little bit of a loop just to get around to them, and hopefully we'll be able to follow up on them again. Now, let's start our journey. We've got a little bit of a way to go. They seem to be going north, and I tried to have a scan and see if I could see them in the distance, but unfortunately I cannot. So they could be just a few steps ahead of us, but never fear, we'll get there. Lots and lots of impala this morning, all sitting out on the open plain. You can see them all dashing off here. I'm just going to keep going a little bit. They're all running now. It's a bit windy. Remember last night, we were all, both myself and Brent, were, I think we were chatting about how all the animals will come out and sit on the open plains when it's a bit windy, and when it's, especially when it gets dark, so that they can see anything coming towards them. Now, it seems as though all the impala and the Sabi sand have indeed done that, because I couldn't even see the ground. I was just seeing lots and lots of impala. But you can see, I just want to show you exactly how cold it is this morning. Everybody's got their electric blankets on. They all look a lot darker than they normally are, and that's just because they're fluffed up, that phylo erection, which allows them to erect all the hair on their body and form a little air pocket between the skin and the fatty layer. And I can tell you now, they are warmer than I am in my nice fluffy jacket. Right, let's carry on though. Let's try and keep up with those lions, because you know when lions start to move, they can move pretty quickly, and they don't always use the road. Sometimes they go straight through. This obviously makes it quite difficult for us to try and keep up. So I'm going to go a little bit quicker than normal. We did see one male and one female's tracks. I presume that pair from last night coming along this road and going straight towards the dam. So possibly everybody's back again. So because I've checked this stretch of road, I am going to go a little bit quicker. And we had a little bit of rain, everyone. Not too much, but it was a little sprinkle. It was a little bit of thunder and lightning, but not for too long. The road isn't really even wet this morning. It's just slightly damp, lots of clouds, as you can see. So we could have an opportunity to get some more rain. The clouds haven't really lifted, quite a thick covering. But it's good for us. Sometimes it's nice during the middle of summer to be able to put on a nice thick warm jacket and keep warm. I don't know about anybody else. I enjoy winter. Summer's great too, especially for the game viewing. But clothing-wise, there's nothing better than putting on a big jacket, long boots, nice pair of jeans. I'm still looking for anything else, just in case we bump into something. I couldn't really hear too much activity last night just because of the thunder that was booming in the distance. But VM said he did hear those lions last night contact calling behind his room. They must have been pretty close. And trying to get ahead towards Mvubu Road, but I know that Mr. Leo Smith is dying to say good morning to all of you.
Welcome. Now we're at this last sight of the Queen of Juma Karula, and no sign of her yet. My name is Brent Leo Smith. I have Dangerous Dave the Dish. Since there was no downpour last night, and I think Karula might have abandoned what was left of this carcass. A quick look. We've checked from below. Nothing there. So where has the queen gone? Has she killed something else in this block? It was perfect hunting weather last night. And when we arrived this morning, there were impala around here, which doesn't necessarily mean she's not here, just means it's unlikely that she is. Now, of course, there have been lions all around this area overnight. We could hear them. And that's just the dawn chorus of our feathered friends making a noise. Emerald spotted wood dove, white browed scrub robin, yellow billed hornbill, amongst others. And I'm just trying to formulate a plan in my head. Now, I have to formulate live because this is, of course, a live African safari. And you can ask me questions about what I'm formulating in my head. And you can do that by sending us an email to questions@wildearth.tv. or hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. Now, if we go black screen, it's of course Dangerous Dave's fault. Ah, there we go, he's noticed. Well done. Okay, let's think. Where has Queen Karula gone? I'd say she's gone that way. That's right, let's go have a look. I was hoping she was going to be so fat and lazy she wouldn't have moved far. But alas, this is not the case. Now it probably happened she would have headed towards the Gallagher, panned for a drink. And then from there, I think she might have headed further south. So we're gonna go have a look. Now there's a lot of animals around here. So with that really windy, dark night, there's also a possibility she just meandered 50 meters and got herself another snack. To do a quick repair. It's not a major one, stop that noise. I'm still listening carefully to see if the queen is about. Oh no. Forgot to pull. There we go. Now watch magic at work here. Oh, it's not that. Then it must be a stick. It is making all that racket. Indeed it is. There we go. Now, of course, there were lions on the Juma Dam cam a little earlier, and I'm not sure which way they're headed, so they could easily head in this direction where we're looking for Karula as well. Okay, so while we try find footprints of the Queen of Juma, and even possibly bump into the Nkuruma pride around here, and let's go see how Taylor's hunt for the lions is going.
Welcome again, everybody. We are dashing to try and find these lions. So I'm sneaking across the dam wall this morning, being very naughty. But I want to get to these lions before these lions get away from us. So off we go. And hopefully we're going to get them just up ahead. Just watching where I'm going over here, that I don't go over the edge. Very little rain. I'm not even sure how much rain we had. Maybe just a few mils, but the ground doesn't seem wet at all. Okay, had the lion tracks going towards the dam. Now we need to get them going the opposite way. Okay, now let's have a quick look here. Yeah, those are the lions going towards the water. Okay, sorry, I'm just quickly just letting VM know what's happening with the water. I mean, with the lion tracks. Brent's calling me. Go, Brent. Just chatting to Brent, everyone. Apparently they were going north over the dam wall towards Mvubu Road. I'm on Mvubu Road now. I haven't seen anything just yet. Alright, just updating Brent with what's happening, but nothing just yet. So I just saw their footprints walking all towards the dam. I didn't see them, any tracks crossing out just yet. So perhaps they maybe crossed a little bit further east, but we will carry on here. Just keep checking, that's all we can do at the moment. Now it's very difficult if they have gone straight through the block. We won't be able to follow them right now. So I believe that while you were watching the dam cam, you saw all those lions in the tree, and Bula Ray this morning would like to know, why is it that lions don't climb trees like leopards do? Now, Bulure, it's just simply a way of predators being able to live in the same area without directly sort of having to compete with each other. So, obviously, if you have leopards living on the ground like cheetahs and lions did, and not taking their food up a tree, they're just going to get everything stolen, very much the same way as a cheetah get their... Oh, we've got Brent. Very much the same way as a cheetah get their food stolen. Right, let's say hello to Brent very quickly. Hello.
Hello.
How's it?
You that way.
I'm going to go that way, and then I'm going to go the cut line. I'm just going to check and then maybe come back down.
Maybe have a look for Karula tracks so if she comes up.
I'll have
way.
A look there
as
well.
I can't see anything going south.
Maybe you'll pick up something else going east.
Yeah,
we're just doing a little crisscross this morning. Brent and I've completely swapped ways. I started on the east, going east, but now we've ended up that we've crossed paths again. He started on the west, but now he's going east again. And we haven't seen anything just yet. I'm also going to keep out, look out for Karula's track to see if she possibly came this way last night. But Boulare, sorry, to carry on with your question. So it's amazing how evolution has allowed leopards to be able to climb trees so that they can try and avoid having their kills stolen all the time, because they're not the biggest cats, I'm afraid. And the leopards, obviously much smaller than the lions. So lions can climb trees. They can go up quite well. Unfortunately, coming down is a different story. They just don't have the well-developed muscles in the shoulders and the legs that the leopards will use in order to sort of hold their weight and stop them from falling out of a tree. And the lions are a lot more bigger and a lot bulkier. A leopard is built nice and slick and lean, and so they are able to go in and out of trees a little bit easier. But in Kenya and Tanzania, you see lions in trees quite often. I don't know if you've ever seen them. They're known as the famous tree climbing lions of Tanzania. Hang on, let's sort of have a look here. Whose footprints did I see now? Probably hyena, but it's always good just to double check. Hyena. Not very nice hyena tracks. And those lions will actually climb up the trees in order to avoid the biting insects that are all down on the ground. I thought that's quite clever. But again, it's not very big trees. They sort of just go up a meter or two, maybe a little bit higher, rest there for most of the day. Very much how a leopard rests, legs dangling over the side. And then obviously at that height, it's quite easy for them, for the lions to actually climb down. We're just scanning, looking. The ground is all right here. I think this area that we're on now seems to have got a little bit more rain than it did further east, because sort of from Philemon's cutline side, it looked quite dry. The ground didn't look like it had any raindrops in it, but this road definitely got some sprinkles on it last night. Hello, butterfly. Oh, we've just got some zebra tracks. Hopefully we're going to pick up something soon, or hopefully Brent picks up on those lions. I suspect that those lions did go a little bit further east. So maybe we're going to switcheroo again. Maybe I'm going to find Karula and Brent is going to find the lions. Though I'm sure Brent is itching to see a leopard. I don't think he's seen a leopard for a... Oh no, he saw one yesterday, very briefly. I forgot, he saw quarantine. But I'm sure he'd enjoy slightly longer sighting with lovely Karula and her cubs. So we're just coming up to the cut line in a few moments. It's bumpy here. Oh, we've got a little common dacre. Can you see it in there? Let's see if it's going to hang around. Maybe it will, maybe it won't. The dacre never seem to stay put for too long. A little female. Also very fluffed up. And off she goes. Very secretive animals, the second smallest antelope that we see in this area. So when we do see them, it's normally just a very quick glimpse, like what you just witnessed, and then off they go. I don't blame them for being so shy and nervous of us, even in the vehicles. If you're living on your own, you're having to watch your own back all the time. Right, let's head to Brent.
There's one lioness. He's just testing this female giraffe. We've just bumped into the whole Nkuma pride. Cubs and all. There's a bit of pandemonium going on. There's just lions all over the place. And the giraffe hasn't moved far. You can see, there we go. The cubs actually started running after the giraffe with the lioness. I think they were more following the lioness than chasing the giraffe. Oh, yes. Happy, happy cubbies. I'm just going to move back a little bit. Now, what quite often happens when lions are hunting giraffe, it's very seldom that they do the spectacular. I know there's another lioness coming out of the bush. Oh, the giraffe is now going high speed. There goes the giraffe. Now this is a good area for them to hunt giraffe. It looks like a young male giraffe. So he's running towards the Mwashi River. So quite often lions have the most success hunting giraffe is when they push them through to an area like that and it causes them to trip and stumble. Now, one of the prides, well, there have been a couple of prides I've spent a lot of time with that were expert giraffe hunters, and one of their tactics in the Kruger in the Lebombo concession was to chase them, try to chase them uphill. As they tried to run up a steep bank, they would fall down and the lions would pounce on them. Now, in northern Botswana, the other pride, I knew that they was very good at hunting lions. What they used to do is actually chase the giraffe towards springhare burrows, and their feet would fall through the sand and they would trip over. Oh, look at that. Left, 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 left. Lioness is playing. There they go. So you don't have to be a cub to be playful. And adult lions also play quite a bit, especially on a lovely cool morning like this. And you can see they've digested all their buffalo, so they are a bit peckish, and by no means starving. The giraffe is still watching them. Let's stick with the lion. So I've seen three adult lionesses so far and about six cubs, but I'm sure everyone's around and about. Oh, there you go. Now, giraffe will often stand relatively close to an animal like a lion and watch with their great height. It's quite difficult for a lion to sneak up on them. Let's just go forward a bit then. Let's get down. Just need to let Tax and Aubrey know. Tax or Aubrey coming? Hello, guys. Always great to catch up with Dinkahumas. Incoming trouble. Hello, Troubles. Now Sally's wondering why would they leave the buffalo? More than likely, Sally, and Sally is in Oregon, because the buffalo is finished. No more meat to eat. Okay. So let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So all cubs are here. And so far only three lionesses, which probably makes sense. It's two are looking after males at the moment. Okay, they're going into quite a thick little area there. So I'm gonna go around. I know of a little open track that runs into the bush here. Well, let's wait for the last cub to scamper past, or the last three. Here we go, the last lioness is also coming down from the termite mound. That looks like Amber. Hi, Amber. Now, she was the one leading the chase on the giraffe. Okay, let's... We're going to go back across the tailor while we try maneuver our way through these thickets.
So Viam and I are just heading around very quickly to go and check Buffalo's Hook Dam. And I believe you had a lioness chasing a giraffe around. That's fantastic. It seems as though they're getting braver and braver than Kahumas. It's not the first time, although I've seen them chasing a giraffe around too. So it was only that young lioness. Now, it's been quite interesting. The lion tracks are going everywhere. They're all over all the roads at the moment. So perhaps because you've only got the three adult lionesses, maybe we're going to find some more. Now, I do hear some squirrels alarm calling in the distance, but I don't trust squirrels all the time. Sometimes they shout for absolutely nothing and just sort of calling to be territorial. But we will have a quick look around. I'm just coming up here to Buffalo's Hook Dam. It doesn't seem like there's anything just yet at first glance, but we will stop and just have a quick look. Always good just to spend just a few minutes just looking and listening to see what's around you. But this morning, Lando, good morning Lando, he was wondering, we have a look, a little scan around, how long does it take you to sort of learn about the different tracks and signs that the animals leave behind them? Not too long, sort of once you've been guiding for a few months, you already start to pick it up. But obviously, the longer you do it and the more practice, the more tracking you do, the easier it becomes to start straight away pick up on a different animal's track. And we can't see anything just yet. So the lion tracks are quite easy. If we find some nice big lion tracks that are not distorted by the little raindrops, I will definitely show you. When you don't have a nice clean track, unfortunately, sometimes on camera it can be quite hard to actually make out what it is. But we will look for some good ones. We're going to keep just driving around here. I'm going to check Inyala Road next. I'm going to go all the way down. Possibly they seem to like this entire drainage system around here. And we did see a big herd of buffalo, but in the far distance... Ooh, hang on, we've got some... I'll just show you one more thing. How far back is it? Ah, there we go. So, looking at some lovely lion dung there. It looks very much like a buffalo's dung. Unfortunately, it isn't a buffalo dung. See how very black it is? And every now and then we're going to get a smell. You can actually see little pieces of hair in there too, if you look very carefully, little bits of hair. So, and this looks quite fresh. This doesn't look too old, but possibly this is from maybe yesterday, maybe last night, from that male and female that were lurking around here. And I do see some more dung up ahead. So let's try and carry on. But like I said, if I find some nice tracks, I'll definitely show you. And they love these drainage systems. Lots of buffalo. And that big herd of buffalo we saw was in Buffalo's Hook, probably about 300 meters from the boundary. It was quite difficult to try and establish where those buffalo were going. But we haven't had any big herds of buffalo, so possibly they're coming from the north and coming down towards the south, which would be very exciting. Maybe they walk straight towards the Kahumas. Wouldn't that be quite exciting? Now, I know Nyala Road is treacherous for gremlins, so I do apologize if I do just disappear at some point. Lots and lots of drainage, and sometimes we go out of sort of signal. I'm just having a quick little scan around here. See if I can find some lion tracks, nice ones. So sort of realizing that these Nkuhumas seem to like sort of three roads. They like Inyala Road, they like Hyena Road, and they also like Gowri Cutline. It seems to be their favorite spot, and then anywhere else in between is good too. It's a good technique though that they're using now, just hunting along the drainage. They're hidden, there's lots of obstacles for animals. If they are chasing anything, potentially they could fall over, which would obviously mean it'd be very easy then for them to jump on the back of a buffalo that's tripped and fallen, or even on a giraffe. Wouldn't it be great if they did manage to successfully bring down an adult giraffe? And we have been seeing a lot of giraffe and a few with calves, so perhaps they find a giraffe with a calf. It'll be interesting to see if they do try and go for it. Let's head back across to Brent though and see how those little cubs are doing.
They've just stopped behind me here. I still think they're going to move this morning. So we've got two adult lionesses right here, amber eyes closest to us. And it looks like all the cubs are heading this way now. Look at that face. So some of them are feeding off the lioness. It seems like no one wants to be left out. Auntie Amber not impressed. I'm hungry. Amber's still looking towards where that giraffe disappeared. So much complaining. So the third adult lioness is coming in. From the left, she might, there we go, you see her coming through the bush there. And the last of the remaining cubs. And you can see Amber in the foreground, quite focused. On something, I'm pretty sure it's that giraffe. Just gotta be on the game drive radio for a second. Standing by. They are actually just a bit to the west.
Orbs, there's that little mud wallow just to the west of Junction Central and Gari Cut Line. Just if you drive around that and then head a little bit south, they're out in the open, it's very nice here. FM. Guys, I'm just keeping quiet so you can hear these incredible noises. Tax, if you can get in front of me, it'll be a good view. That's enough. So the lionesses are hungry, and so are the cubs. And I think there's one mom missing. She's not too far away, but she is. They're definitely not wanting to feed too much. And you can see old Amber's still quite focused on that giraffe as it disappears. Hi Lauren. Lauren would like to know, do the cubs ruin a lot of hunts when they first start moving with the adults on the hunt? They do, Lauren. Not more from youthful exuberance, especially when they're so that six months to about a year and a half old. They can actually be quite cumbersome while hunting. Quite often, after a couple of failed hunts, they get snarled at and left in a thicket. You can see subtlety's not quite their thing yet. Auntie Amber's gonna see. You can almost see what's going through her brain to the rest of the pride. Control your children, please. I wonder how long it's going to take Amber Eyes to get up and move. I think it's going to be quite soon. Now the lion lioness. The lionesses are purposely lying so the cubs can't get to lactate. Okay, I'm just gonna ignore them. I'm going to ignore them and try sleep. Hi, Mercedes in San Francisco. Mercedes is wondering if I think when the lionesses or the adults are hunting, the cubs can hear their communications. I don't, Mercedes. I think most of the communication done while hunting is non-audible. So I think it's mostly visual communication that happens while the lions are hunting. So they will look to body language and things like that to determine how they should act and where they should go. I think it's non-audio, I don't say verbal, but they don't talk, do they? They oomph. Non-vocal, thank you Rebecca in Final Control. Non-vocal communication is what happens during the hunt. So of course there are five adult lionesses. Oh no. In this pride. Only three here at the moment. Well, that's not unusual. And she's trying to get away from them. She's popped out the other side of the bush here. But she's taken quite a few of them in tow. Let's see how long her patience lasts while they feed. How many are there now? One, two, three, four, five and on its way. The piece did not last long. Six on its way now as well. Oh no, she's up again. Okay, so as the lions move off, we're just going to sit here and see where they go next. While we do that, let's go see what Taylor's up to.
Look what VM spotted perched in this marula tree, everyone. That is a bataleur. Look at it sitting there all fluffed up. Everybody's very cold. Everybody seems to be procrastinating. And there are no birds flying except the hornbills this morning. Very lovely as it sits there. It stands out quite nicely, that black dot. And you see that just there in the left-hand corner of your screen. And then we go again. And this has to be the most incredibly colored eagle that we see in this area. I don't think there's any other eagles that have got that amazing red, bright red facial plumage, as well as those red legs and then the dramatic white wing paneling. It's very special and they're very easy to identify, firstly because of those colors, but if you're struggling a little bit and you're looking at a bataleur as it's soaring in the sky, the thing that you must look for is its tail, because you won't see one. You'll often see that the feet stick out quite nicely. Normally you don't get to see the feet while they're flying, but in the bataleur's case you will. You'll see them dangled back where the tail should be. And then another thing is that they're very wobbly when they fly. And that's because of the lack of the tail. Because it's not that they don't have one, it's just it's much shorter. And that, remember, those tails act as a rudder. It helps them sort of balance in the air. And when you've got a small one, unfortunately, you tend to flap around a little bit and wobble quite a bit. And that's where their name comes from, the batelier. It's a French derivative, which means tightrope walker. And I think it describes their action as they're flying very well. But you can see this one is just preening and just unhooking all the feathers. That's very important for the bateliers and all the other birds to constantly groom themselves. You can see how it's pulling out that feta. Obviously had feta cheese for dinner last night, not feta. I meant feather. And that's because all in between those feathers, there's tiny little barbs, little hooks. And they have to groom them and keep them nice and clean so that they can realign those hooks on the feather, which helps them to fly. You have very messy feathers and you've got lots of wind and things coming through. And they won't do what they're supposed to do, I'm afraid. Amazing birds. We often get quite confused every now and then with the juveniles. I don't know if you've ever seen a juvenile bachelor eagle. Maybe I can find one in a book. But they can sometimes look a little bit like a tawny eagle, especially if you can't see the tail. And if you're not 100% sure, and you're not 100% sure of the colouring of a juvenile... my mind just went from here. Juvenile tawny eagle's facial sort of skin. Then you can very easily get confused. But let me compare too quickly. Let's get to Batelier, my old book that I have here. Batelier, you're on page 92, and I presume that the other eagles will be quite close by. Let's have a look here. Balance it, see if I can bend the book. So if you go down here, can you see how they're brown? And especially the sub-adult on the left, so over here, you could very easily get that confused with a tawny eagle if you weren't 100% certain. It's always good to look for that tail. Now, it can take them about 7 years before they get their adult plumage. It's quite a long time, I'd think, to become an adult if you're a bird. Let's see if I can find the tawny eagle. Oh, Marshall, maybe you're on the next page. I don't think it'll be too far away. No, here we are. And this is why you can get confused. Is if you have a look at all those birds. Very, very, very similar. But then again, much, much smaller though than the tawny eagle. I think the bateliers tend to be a little bit, not quite as eagle-like, big long neck that you sort of see with the tawny eagle. They're a little bit more frumpy, these bateliers. But that was very nice. It's still just sitting there perched in the tree. And I think it's hoping that the warm weather is going to come about so it can start its day. Though it seems to be warming up quite nicely. The clouds are lifting. However, I don't think the sun is going to come out today. And while we carry on searching for the other lions, or perhaps Tingana, Brent has got two lovely lionesses for you.
And Amber Eyes has finally got some peace. Now the rest of the cubs have moved off down where Taxon is heading. And one lioness and Amber here. I just wanted to wait to see if they come scuttling back after they irritate mother again. Now, Jen B says it looked like the lionesses were refusing the oldest cubs. And I don't think that's the case, Jen. I think they were refusing all the cubs, to be honest. I just don't think they've got a lot of milk at the moment. And they're when all 8 try and feed off you at the same time, I'm sure it's quite an uncomfortable experience. I'm going to try and see where are all the little cubbies. That's okay. We're going to move a little bit away from the sleeping adults towards the cubs. Ah, there they are. So, Jen was wondering if it's the start of the weaning process. I don't think just yet. I just think that lionesses were refusing all the cubs due to the fact that they were all trying to feed at the same time. And she's actually managed to, it looks like she's maybe feeding one cub at the moment. We'll have a look when we get a bit closer. How's that for you, Dave? I think that's the best gap. Okay, so here we go. Seems like they've now decided they cannot harass anymore. I think it was more the number of cubs trying to feed at the same time, Jen, that irritated the lionesses. So if we come down to the left slightly there, Dave, behind the gwari bush, here we go, a little bit more left. Here we are. If you look carefully through there, there's one of the larger cubs feeding on that lioness. So there we go. So I don't think they're quite starting the weaning process just yet. Sweetness. Now it looks like they're settling down for the next while. It is a cool day. Any creature that might wander up might set the lionesses off hunting. Can you hear some elephants in the distance as well? Branches breaking, cracking. Oh, tired kitties. Now, I just said I heard some elephants, and it looks like Taylor's caught up with them, so let's go have a look.
Can you guess what animal we are looking at? If you guessed elephant, you are correct. We have stumbled across quite a large breeding herd of elephants. They're all scattered around here. Quite a few of them are off into the thicket. But luckily, we've got a couple that are out and about in the open. And this is clearly a female elephant. You can see by that big square head that she's got. And she is loving the bush willows. She's eating all the trees. They seem to have devoured this entire area. I can just see lots of destruction around us. But we all know why they are pushing the trees down. It's not because they are frustrated or anything. It's because they are hungry. And there are very little nutrients in the bush at this time of the year. And the grass is still a little bit too short for some of these elephants, especially in this area. And I think the grasses, the tufts are quite long enough just yet for them to pull out of the ground with their trunk. Hello, big girl. You're going to walk right past us. Just going to duck so I don't get into your way. There she goes. Now she's going to feed right in front of my vehicle. Hello, Gil. Time to see what she's going to do. Now you're going to go back that way. I'm not sure. Oh, wow. Look at this elephant pushing this tree over. Look, being obstructed by a big bum. But now we can actually watch how as they push that. Oh, wow. With absolute ease. It's just amazing the strength that the elephants have. I need to reposition again, everybody. What I would like to do is perhaps go a little bit further forward so we can see all of them quite nicely. So I think let's do that. Actually, maybe we could even reverse and watch these other characters. Or can we see them? Oh no, we can see them. We don't have to go. Everybody's pushing and pulling the trees over. Snap it off. You're going to have to use a little bit more force, I'm afraid. This one's trying very hard. No, that one's too flexible. I'm probably going to try another branch. There's so many elephants, I don't know where to look. We will watch this one for now, and as soon as another one moves into a better spot, then we will watch them too. But all the elephants seem to be doing exactly the same thing. They're just mimicking each other, breaking the branches, chewing all the bark off, and then spitting them out. That's quite nice. They're doing us a nice favor. If you were wanting a walking stick, and you know how you often have to cut and take a knife and remove all of that bark, well, the elephants do it quite nicely for you. So I recommend using one of the sticks, one of the branches that they've already taken care of. Oh, be careful you don't hit that little elephant. She's given up. She's not breaking it anymore. Just chewing it. She decided it's a bit too difficult to snap. Well, that's fine. When it's a flexible tree, then just bend it down to the height of your mouth and you pop it straight in and you chew and enjoy. Oh no, there we go. Now it's snapping. Oh, you hear all that crunching. And that young bull came racing over when he heard that sound. He was having a bit of trouble trying to break it. Seems as though he's going to come in and try and steal this female's branch that she broke off. We see that quite a bit, actually, where one does all the hard work and then the others just come in and take over. We saw that the other morning, actually, where there was one elephant that was being a bit of a bully. There we go. That's a little bit of grass you could perhaps pull off the ground. You can see this elephant's now attempting to pull at the grass. It's a little bit short, though. There's a few pieces that it is able to pick up. There we go, like that. You see the roots are a little long enough for it to pull out of the ground. Now, I know Morning Glory was wondering how long the grass has to be in order for the elephants to start feeding on it. Or perhaps is it dependent on the species of grass? Now, it's a bit of both. Some of the grass species, unfortunately, aren't the tastiest, and not all the animals will eat them all the time. However, the grass doesn't need to be too long. It needs to just be about more than about 5 centimeters or so, just so that it's off the ground, because those trunks, they do struggle. Oh, I'm going to break the branch again. They do struggle to pull the grass out if it is too short, but it's getting to that length now. This area just doesn't look like it's had very much water, very much rain. Now you just need to pull that out. It is completely snapped off. There we go. Actually, she's going to do a bit of javelin. That little one going in to see if there's anything left. Seeing if it can maybe pull a bit of bark off at the base. No, I don't think you're strong enough. Oh, we've got another big elephant coming straight towards us. Look at this. Look at her coming right over here. Hello, big girl. Let's just have a look at her. She crosses the road. Hello, big girl. Maybe she's heard all the snapping of those branches and is wondering what the commotion is all about. Wow, just to give you an idea how close she is. little bit of tension, not from us. You can see those elephants showed us absolutely no aggression as well, at all. And obviously this elephant that we're looking at now, and the one that we were watching that was breaking off, doesn't seem to enjoy this female. And she let off a bit of a trumpet slash tummy rumble. And she moved away very quickly. And the female that we're watching now, she didn't even react at all. She was just sort of like, oh, okay. Well, if you don't like me, well, then you can move. I'm going to stay here and carry on eating. So I just moved out of the way in case they did start pushing and shoving each other. It's not uncommon to see a little bit of tension between elephants and between the females. It can indeed happen. But normally they sort it out quite easily. Fantastic. Right, we're going to stick here with the elephants for a little bit longer. Let's go see how the Nkahumas are doing.
Good morning and welcome on to Auckland Park for your live African safari. Now, my name is Brent, my cameraman is Dave, and guess what we've got for you? Baby lions! Look at that, a whole bunch of baby lions. Of course, they're not called baby lions. If we're being proper, they're called lion cubs. I can see one. There we go. Let me go off to there. Two, three, four, five, six, seven. So there are eight cubs in total in this pride, but we can see seven. The one is lying next to the mom. There we go, in that thicket there. Oh, it's gone. It was lying next to mom. Where did you go? Oh, and there's another lioness moving through to join them. So there's three adult lionesses, two mommies, and one auntie. There she goes. Let's go see, is she going to go join the rest of the cubs, or is she going to lie down next to the other female? And of course, it's Mrs. Cottrell, Mrs. Govender, and Miss Bushell's classes at Auckland Park who are joining you today. We're very excited to have you on drive with us. And what a good way to start. Guys, send me your questions. What would you like to know about lions? It'll be great to hear from you. Now, there's still one lion behind us, and she's sleeping under a bush. Now, I'm hoping, because it's a cool morning, that these lions might move again. Although I seem to think they're going to be sleeping here for quite a long time. Now, lions will sleep for about 20 hours a day. So if you like snoozing, it's good to be a lion. Now, of course, lions aren't the only animals that live out here in the African bush. And Taylor is on the other car, and she also wants to say hello to you. So let's go see what she's got.
Good morning. I hope you are all having a fantastic day, and welcome to our lovely show that we have. And we are watching some elephants. My name is Taylor, and on camera with me, we have got Viam. So I hope you are all very excited to be able to do this on a lovely morning. I mean, I wish I could come to school every single day and have an opportunity to watch a show like this. How exciting. So if you want to ask any questions, you're welcome to ask your teachers, and they will send you the questions and we'll answer them for you. So we're having a look at a big breeding herd of elephants. Now, there's quite a few here. I haven't been able to count each and every one just yet. They are all moving through some of the thick bush. No, the bush is not too thick at the moment because it's a little bit dry. and you can see them going off. I think what we're going to have to do, because we're losing these ones, we're going to have to reposition very quickly, because I saw quite a few down in the distance, and possibly we'll have a better view of them. Goodness, amazing. I'm sitting here surrounded by elephants. Let's go down a little bit further and have a look. Now, I have a question for all of you at Auckland Park. What is your favorite animal in the African bush? And so if you want to let me know, you can let your teachers know and then they will tell me. And I look forward to hearing some of your names. Oh, we've got a little elephant you can see crossing the road ahead of us. We've got another little one. Perhaps we will see this group of elephants coming through. Let's see. Hello, little elephant. This one is just eating right here. You can hear the elephants rumbling in the distance. Now that is how they communicate. That's how they talk to each other. And what that is it's a stomach rumble. That one was a little bit of a nasally call that they were doing. There's a little bit of tension. Some of the elephants are not happy with each other. Perhaps they had a little argument last night and now they're trying to resolve the issue. So I think we're going to be hearing a lot of noise, which is amazing. Because normally you don't hear the elephants making too much noise. Now, this is a male elephant. Yeah, he's quite young though. But you can see he doesn't really worry about following mom all the time. Now, Pierre wants to know, good morning. How do you tell the difference between male and female elephants? Now, if you have a look at their heads, you'll see that this elephant's head is quite round. Can you see that? Very round on the head there. Hello, little boy. And that is the easiest way when you're looking at them, because sometimes you don't always get to see the entire body of the elephant. Now, we all know the male animals in the bush, the boy animals, they are much larger than the girls. So when it's a little one, it's a bit difficult. So you look for the roundness in the head, whereas a female elephant, and I'll try and show you the difference, their head is very square, almost like a big block on top of their heads. But let's carry on going down a little bit further and we will hopefully get some more. They are all spread out over here. Good morning, Claire. Claire wants to know if there are any baby elephants. Claire, I'm going to especially find you a baby elephant, so keep watching, keep your eyes peeled, because I think we're going to see one just around the corner. Now they're moving off into the very thick vegetation. Come back, little elephants. Don't run away from us. Ooh, look at the obstacles that they've left in the road for me. Now this is very naughty. Now normally what I would do is I would get out and I'd remove all the branches. However, the elephants are very close by and it would be unsafe to do so. But I'm just going to go over the top of them with Wendy. Wendy's got some nice big tires and she's able to go over them. So these elephants are walking down, and I'm just seeing if there's a road here. No, not yet. We're just trying to find a good spot where we can see these elephants again, because they are moving quite quickly. Obviously somebody has given the go-ahead to say, right, troops, let's move out. Almost like an army. You can see one Ellie through there. Sorry, everybody, your screen's a little bit sideways, so don't worry about turning your head. VM is going to fix that now. I just had to park on a hill. Here's another elephant. Not a baby, Claire, but we're looking. There are definitely quite a few babies in this herd. And normally when you see a herd of elephants, it is made up of lots of mums and sisters and grannies, as well as all their babies. So I'm sure we'll see some. But while I try and find a better spot for us to see some little elephants, let's go back to Brent and have a look at the lions.
So one of the females has moved around. I'm just trying to get us a view of where she is with the cubs. Oh, but she's not very happy with them at the moment. Hello, Miss Pearson. Ms. Pearson would like to know where we are. We are in a private game reserve called the Sabi Sands Game Reserve, which is in the northeast of South Africa in the province of Mpumalanga. Now, Mpumalanga means where the sun arises. Langa is sun and Mpuma is to come out. Oh, let's just listen to these lions quickly. So the lions are quite hungry and the cubs are trying to drink milk. But the lionesses are getting a little bit annoyed with them. Hi, Cam. Cam is wondering how old the cubs are. Well, Cam, there's two different ages. And, oh, three actually, but two sets are very close together. They're probably about five months already? Wow. And then the others are around just over three months. Oh, here we go, following after one of the mothers. Yeah, that soft growl. Grr, go away, grr, go away. And the others are all snoozing up there. So, Miss Pearson, as I was saying, we're in the Sabi Sands Game Reserve. It is part of the Greater Kruger. So there's no fence between us and the Kruger National Park, which means it's an open system, so all the animals can move about freely. Okay, let's just try and move slightly. Ooh, there's a big hole there. Gal would like to know, how long will it take for them to become adult lions? Here we go. I'll be with you in a second, I'm just watching the hole and watching out for some thorns. You okay there, Dave? It's always important to move quite slowly around these animals. We don't want to give them a fright. Change my angle slightly. How's that for you, Dave? That's better. There we go. So, Gal was wondering, how long does it take for them to become adult lions? Well, they're generally considered adults at about three, or 2.5 to 3 years old. Hello, little one. You can see there's two drinking from the mom at the back. Doesn't this one closest to us look naughty? Now Miriam's wondering why there are no male lions here. Well, Miriam, male lions actually spend quite a bit of time away from the pride. So, this pride is under the protection of a coalition, which is a group of males, and there are four of them, and they are called the Birmingham Boys, and they have a massive area that they have to defend from other male lions. So they go off patrolling, and also this is not their only pride of lions. So a male coalition like that, they look after three different prides. So they could be with one of the other prides, but they move through and they're constantly roaring to protect these cubs, to make sure no other males come in and kill them. Oh, and another one coming to join. Amira is wondering, are any of the cubs born blind? Well, Amira, it is a possibility. But that cub would not survive, definitely not to this age. And out here, it is survival of the fittest. So a cub that's born blind or born deformed generally won't make it past a week or two. Oh, look at them sleeping, all cuddled up. Now Piper is wondering, are these cubs all related? Is it a family? Well, it is indeed, Piper. So what you have here is all the female lions in a pride, so all the moms and aunties and cousins will all be related. Oh, look, he's getting stuck in there. We could see some cub fighting. Hold up.
Okay, so Piper, to finish what I was saying, so all the females are always related. So they are sisters, cousins, and aunties and mothers. And what happens is when the male lions get to about 3 years old, their dads chase them away. And they've got to go find a new family. But the females will stay with the pride, so all females in a pride are always related. Now Millie's wondering, do we have any white lions here? Now Millie, we don't, but that doesn't mean we can't get. So white lions is what the coloration of a white lion is actually a natural phenomenon called leucism. So it's the lack of a color pigment, not like albinism, but so it is a genetic trait that is common, not common, but is in the lions in the low felt. And the Timbavati Game Reserve, which is famous for its white lions, is not too far from here. And the male lions that are here now actually come from the Timbavati. So there is always a possibility we might get a white lion, but it's very unlikely, because it means the females would also have to carry that recessive gene. Okay, well, we sit here. Taylor is still with those elephants, so let's go have a look.
The elephants are coming out, everybody. They're having to use their 4x4 gears this morning because they're coming down quite a steep bank. Maybe we'll get lucky and able to watch it again. They seem to have settled down a little bit now, which is quite nice. They were a little bit unhappy moving through this drainage system. Coming to eat all the nice green leaves that are down here. Oh wow. I want to see if I can go a little bit further forward for you to watch this big elephant. Good morning, Rachel. You hope you're enjoying this morning. Now Rachel wants to know, where do the elephants sleep? Rachel, the elephants sleep wherever they like. They don't have specific homes. So they just carry on throughout the day. They eat lots and lots of food. Have a look here. And then when they feel a little bit tired, they will find a nice tree with lots of shade, especially if it's hot, and they will just stand there and go to sleep. So they don't always lay down. Sometimes you see the little babies, they'll lay down next to mom, and then mom will just stand there quietly. Maybe she rests her leg. You know how you can cross your legs? The elephants will do that too, or cross a back leg and put their trunks on the ground and rest them. And they have little siestas throughout the entire day. So elephants don't sleep for very long. What they do for most of the day is they have to eat and eat and eat all day long. Now, I don't know if any of you that are watching would like to be an elephant, because you have to eat lots of vegetables all the time. You're having to eat vegetables for 19 hours a day. Can you imagine sitting and eating vegetables for 19 hours a day? I know it was used to be a struggle for me to try and eat vegetables just at dinner. So I don't know how these elephants do it, but it's quite amazing. But that's what they're doing now. They're having breakfast, and then they're going to have breakfast again. And then you can see now she's eating the bark off of the tree. She obviously doesn't want any leaves or any grass. Now, Mama, I know you're wanting to know if we are affected by poaching. And unfortunately, we are. Everywhere in Africa, we are all affected by poaching. But luckily, we've got a very good anti-poaching team that try and protect all the different animals. So not just the rhinos, but the elephants too, and the lions, and the leopards, and the cheetahs, and all the different wildlife that we have in this area. They're trying to look after them. So sometimes you see people walking around, sometimes they're driving in vehicles or flying in helicopters, just looking for all the bad people, and hopefully they can try and catch them. Now, I'm hoping that this female is going to come and walk down so I can show you how good an elephant can go downhill. Because normally you see their big size and you think there's no ways that an elephant can go down a steep bank. Well, they're very good at it, actually. I think it's amazing how they're able to hold back their weight and not topple over and do a somersault. They engage that 4x4 gear, they put their heels in the ground, and then they walk down very slowly. Hopefully we'll be able to see that. I think it would be quite nice. And I'm sure once this lovely lady over here has finished eating, that they're going to come down. Because the rest of them are all slowly coming down in front of us, behind us. Did you see how dirty her tusks were as well? Look at all that mud and sand that's stuck there. And that's because of it being so dry at the moment that there isn't much for them to eat. They often will dig for the roots and the bulbs underneath the ground. It could also be from when they like to have a mud bath. I'm sure that you've maybe seen some videos, or if you're lucky enough to actually have seen elephants having a mud bath, it's quite special. And then, of course, every inch of their body gets very dirty. Good morning, Romy. Romy, you would like to know, how long do elephants live for? Elephants live for about anywhere between 60 and 70 years old. Isn't that a long time? Almost like humans. I think we just sometimes live a little bit longer. And unfortunately, Romy, their age, well, how long they can live for is not determined and because of old age. It's actually because of their teeth. So I'm not talking about the tusks now, I'm actually talking about the molars that they have inside their mouth. So the teeth that you have at the back of your mouth, right at the back, the elephants have got 6 sets of those teeth. So those are the only types of teeth they have. They have them on the side, on the bottom, and the top jaw. Now, because they only have got 6 sets of teeth, they get a new set of teeth every 10 years. Imagine if you had a new sets of teeth coming through every 10 years. So when those teeth have worn down, so from eating all the vegetation, their teeth grind down, then they push up and move forward like a conveyor belt, and the teeth pop out, and then the new set of teeth come through. And that's why they reckon that they only live anywhere between 60 and 70 years. So Zen would like to know, because I was obviously talking about the drought, and Zen would like to know, is there enough water for the animals to drink? Yes, there is. We're quite fortunate. I'm just going to have a look at another elephant in the distance. We're quite fortunate that the water wasn't the problem this year, Zen. You know what it was? It was that we didn't have enough rain to make enough food for the animals. That was the biggest problem. But luckily, there are a few natural pans, and we are pumping a little bit of water into little watering holes for the animals to drink as well. But luckily, we had some rain. We haven't had too much rain out here, unfortunately, but we did have some a week and a half ago, and as well as last night, but just a little sprinkle, and that's why we've got all these lovely new green grass shoots coming through. We need to reposition everybody. I believe that the elephants are coming out just on the other side of this drainage, so I'm going to have to do a bit of reversing, which is quite fun to watch. We're in the sand too, so being in the sand is obviously quite difficult compared to driving normally. But it's lots of fun, and I'm sure you're all very excited to one day when you can drive a car. I'm going to look over my shoulder so I don't take us out by any trees, and also so that I try and stay in the now and then and stick my tongue out, because it helps me concentrate. Ooh. So I haven't heard any responses yet. My favorite animal are the elephants, so actually getting to see me with my favorite animals in the whole wide world. Right, we're almost here. We swing back, and we're going to be with those elephants very soon. Let's try go around quickly. There's a road just up ahead, and then I'm sure they're going to be out and on this road. I'll just try go a little bit quicker. Like Claire, I'm still looking for a teeny tiny baby elephant for you. Now, I know there were one or two, and perhaps that they're coming out into the open. We're going to see one. So I hope you're all ready and waiting. Let's go and have a look. Where are the elephants? They're moving so quickly. I can see some of them already have crossed into the thicket, but I'm sure there are still a few out over here. We've just got to find them now. Oh, we saw some coming through over here. I'm just trying to listen. Now you'd think, have a look here. Look at this mud. We must have just missed them, but there's still some more coming through. So the elephants were obviously in here having a little bit of a mud bath. Maybe we should just wait and see if they're going to come to us. But you can see them in the distance already. But that's not all of them. There's still lots to come through. All having a feeding on the other side already. They moved very quickly. I'm surprised that we didn't even hear them splashing in the mud because we weren't too far away. It's not a very hot day. Now, normally the elephants will only splash in the mud like that when it is very hot. So I mean, they just came through, had a little splash around, and then stopped and then carried on. But I can hear some more. Just trying to work out where exactly they're going to come out.
It's your earpiece in.
Oh, no. It's in now. Sorry, everybody. I lost my lifeline, my earpiece. I couldn't hear what anybody was saying to me. So Cecilia wants to know this morning, do elephant tusks fall out? They don't. Those are the only teeth that the elephants don't lose. And over many, many, many millions of years, they will stay there now. I think we've got one coming out. Oh, yes, well spotted, VM. So those tusks, which are teeth, they don't... Sorry. Excuse me, I ate an insect, everybody. And so I just want to finish the previous question very quickly. So those teeth, those tusks, aren't used like normal teeth. They're used as digging tools, rather. Now, Emily, good morning to you. Emily, you want to know if I've ever found an elephant's tooth? Yes, I have. Many years ago, I found an elephant's tooth in some dung. And then I moved game reserves and I lost it. And I don't know what happened to it. And it's not something that you find all the time, so it was very, very special, unless you can actually find an elephant skull. Now, we're trying to figure out where these ellies are going to go now, but while... Oh, there's some up ahead. There we go. Let's go around. Ooh, they're running across the road. We're going to get them. No, don't run away from us. Oh, there's lots coming out. Hopefully they're going to hang around for just a little bit. Right, here we go. So now that we're going to have a look at some baby elephants, Lola wants to know, how long do baby elephants stay in their mother's womb for? So the moms are pregnant for 22 months. That's a long time. It's a very long time. Here's a baby elephant. Now, baby elephant, don't disappear. Just going next to mom. And these elephants, these little ones, especially if they are girls, will stay with their mothers for their entire life. They will live in the same herd. There's the little one. Now, that little one's probably about 8 months old, just under a year. And the reason how I can tell that is if you watch how an elephant uses its trunk. That is normally a sign, and it will be able to tell you how old they are. So they take about a year to be able to use their trunks very well, almost like your arm. They've got to train all those muscles, and there's lots and lots of muscles in an elephant's trunk. And by about a year old, they've got a good idea of how to use it. But this one is still struggling a little bit. Now it's disappeared. Another really big female. Now they don't look too big when you're looking at them on the camera. But they weigh up to 4 tons. Kiki wants to know, how on earth did I know that these elephants were here? I just found them. I saw some very fresh dung on the floor and some poop on the ground this morning. And now you can see this one is smelling. So she's got her trunk up, trying to pick up on a better scent. And so I saw the dung on the floor and I saw which way that the footprints were going. So I followed them for a little bit and then we came across them. That's what we have to do, is we have to look for the different tracks and signs that the animals leave behind in the bush, and then we have to try and follow them. and they've all grouped up quite nicely. I'm still looking back to see if any are going to come through and possibly splish and splash in the mud. But now they are enjoying a buffet. Look at all those wrinkles on the skin. Arain, good morning. You've asked quite a difficult question. Arain wants to know how many elephants are born on average every year on this reserve. So now, Arain, that actually, it's a hard one to ask her because there are so many different factors that you have to consider. How old the elephant is. Has she come into estrus yet? So is she ready to have any baby elephants? Are there any males that are around? Maybe she's very stressed and she can't have babies this year. Maybe she's just had a baby. And then that means only in the next 4 or 5 years she's going to have another one. So it's a quite a difficult question to answer. And I don't know the exact answer as to how many baby elephants are born every year. So the elephants have got just over 3.5 million hectares of land to roam around on. So that's quite big. So sometimes it's quite difficult to get every single animal. But it's quite a bit. There's quite a few elephants in this area. Maybe almost 20,000 elephants that roam around here. Good morning, Miss Dane. So, Miss Dane, you're wondering how on earth do these elephants manage to find water during the droughts? Now, a lot of this information is passed on from the grandmothers to the mothers and then passed on to the daughters. So they are taught as they're growing up where the natural pans are. And then remember, elephants have got very good memories, so they will walk and migrate into different areas and in search of water and check spots. Remember, elephants also got those tusks, so they are able to dig for water. So that dry riverbed that we were in, I'm sure there's water under there, and if the elephants were desperate, they would be able to dig and go and get some water. Now, I did look over my shoulder and I saw some more elephants, so I want to turn around very quickly again. They're coming in and out of the bushes very quickly. So when the animals move, we've got to keep moving too. And those ones have disappeared into the very far bush, but we've got some crossing right in front of us. I was pointing out how wrinkly elephants are, and Pandina wants to know why are elephants so wrinkly. Now, Pandina, that's so that it creates more surface area. So you can see they've got lots of wrinkles, but if you had to take an iron and iron out those wrinkles quite nicely, they would have lots of extra skin. So in between the cracks on an elephant's skin, it creates shade, and that actually helps keep them cool. Now, this elephant over here, this mom elephant, she's a little bit upset. I don't know if you saw her tail, how she was pointing it to the side. She's a little bit unhappy with something. I don't think it was us, because some of the others also raced across the road when I was looking over my shoulder. There's another little baby elephant about to cross the road. Here's another one. Hello, little elephant. You see, they haven't even seen the tusks just yet. That's another way how you can tell how old an elephant is that if you see their tusks coming through the folds of skin on their faces, that's normally an indication that they are around 2 years old. And now you can also see the nice square head on this elephant. Can you see that? See how it's very sharp and angled? That is a female. So remember, the male's head is very round, where the female's head is nice and square. Oh, there's lots of elephants popping out of the bushes here. I told you that there were so many. This must be a herd of about 50 elephants. They are everywhere. Well, we're going to stick around with these elephants for a little bit longer and see what they get up to. But I think Brent has got something to show you.
Well, welcome back. And we've left the lions to give some of the other game drives a chance to look. But it's not always about the big hairies and scaries. There's some birds as well. They're right opposite us. There's a very pretty little bird. Here we go. Called a crested barbet. And you see his big bill there. He's a fruit eater. So So that bills to open up some of the hard fruits we get out here in the bush. Lots of striking colours on the bird. You can see why he's called a crested barbet. He's got that big crest on his head. Now, some of you might see these at home in Joburg. They do occur in gardens in Johannesburg. So keep a lookout for crested barbets in your garden. Or even at your school. And behind the barbets are impala. Big herd of impala moving through the bush. Oh, itchy leg. Hi, Rachel. Lovely to hear from you. Now, Rachel's wondering, are there any cheetah on the reserve? Yes, there are. We don't see them that often. Oh, impala starting to run. Looks like they're just playing. There they go. All catching up with the rest of the herd. Now, yes, there are cheetah, Rachel. And we do see them from time to time. Normally further to the east where there's some very big open plains. Okay, impalas, off you go. We're going to keep moving. So I'm looking for a female leopard at the moment who's also got cubs. And she was behind me last night, but she's not where she was yesterday. So I'm looking for her footprints. So that's how we found most of the animals. Yeah, and that's how we found the lions this morning. I found their footprints and we followed their footprints till we found the lions. Lion footprints are easier to follow than leopards because there's more of them and they're much bigger. So I haven't seen any. Oh, I think I see a footprint. Let me just have a look here. Ratty is wondering, what does the crested barbet eat? Now, you saw that very big bill, and that means it eats fruit. It's like marulas and other fruit out here. Now, you've got to have good eyes to spot footprints of animals. Now, I am a bit too close. But I've found the leopard footprints. Let me see. Here we go, Dave. You see that one? And it's quite difficult. So there are the toes. 1, 2, 3, 4. There's the pad. And the back of a cat track always... Oh, my finger's a bit fat. Let me use a stick rather. The back of a cat track always does that. So almost, it's got three little gaps in it. So you can just see it there. So there's one leopard. There's two leopards. So I think she's here with both her cubs. So one of my favorite things is to track big cats. So that's what we're gonna do next. I'm gonna see if I can find these leopards. Isn't this exciting? We're live looking for leopards in the middle of the bush. I wish we had this when I was at school. I'd much rather watch game drives than do maths. Hi, Swazi. Swazi's wondering, how long do leopards stay in their mother's womb for? So, Swazi, that is called gestation, and that's how long it takes a baby to grow inside a mommy. And leopards have quite a short time in the womb, only about 110 days, or about 3 months. Sorry guys, I just gotta be on the radio for a second. Standing by, tax. Tax, I've got in Konzo of Nkuma having Karula and both Mpimpans. They're heading south on Western Edge quarantine. Just listen to this.
Copy, thanks, Tax. So, Swazi, as I was saying, 3 months, they stay inside a mommy's tummy. Now, I'm just trying to see, you've got to look very carefully. Now, Pierre's wondering, how do I know these tracks are fresh? Well, they're not that fresh. So we had a little bit of rain last night, and there's a little bit of raindrops on top of them. So it means they're probably about 6 or 7 hours old. Now, for leopards, that's still good enough to follow. If we're following something like a wild dog, they could be 50 kilometers from here. But there's a strong possibility this leopard would have moved away and gone to sleep somewhere. So I'm going to keep following the tracks. Now, you can tell they're fresh by different ways. And they're nice and clear. They don't have edges that have been blown by the wind. That's probably the best way. Also, the fact is that we know these leopards very well, and we saw them last night, and I know this female leopard's habits. So, and there were lots of lions around where she was last night, so she would have taken her babies and moved away from the lions because the lions were over there. Now, very interesting question from Lola. And that is, at what age do leopards learn to climb trees? Well, Lola, with a lot of animals, there's a sort of instinctive knowledge, so they don't need to be taught. So they do learn how to get better at it, but Lola's wondering, at what age do leopards learn to climb trees? They can climb trees from about 8 weeks old, so very young. It is quite incredible. Making sure I'm still on her tracks. I think she's gone down. Now, leopards will quite often like to walk along the edge of little dry riverbeds. So I'm pretty sure she's gone down into that dry riverbed and she's heading south. So now I've got to think like a leopard to find a leopard. So if I want to find that leopard, I'm going to go ahead and check the next road instead of going track by track by track. And that sometimes makes it much easier for us to find leopards. So we've got to pretend we're a leopard and say, if I was a leopard, where would I go? And if I was a leopard, I'd go down there. So I'm going to go up ahead. Hello, Eva and Piper. Now, they would like to know if we ever see rhinos. And we do. Now, they are obviously having a bit of a tough time at the moment, the rhinos, so we don't show them on the camera to protect them. So that's why we don't show rhinos, but we do see them quite often, actually. Now, it's always important to check. Now, this is a good spot for leopards, and you can see there's a little... Ooh, Quickly, before we say goodbye to you, I've got a very beautiful bird to show you. You got him there, Dave? Look at that. It's a little cardinal woodpecker. Isn't he pretty? Oh. Now, he's looking for bugs that live in the wood, and they'll get them with that incredible beak of his, using it as a hammer. Well, off he goes. Well, Auckland Park, thank you very much for joining us. There were some great questions. We loved hearing from you, and hopefully we'll see you again soon. But for now, we're going to say toodaloo.
Ooh, footprints. Whose footprints do I have next to me? A bit difficult to see, and they were definitely very late last night though, before the rain. Trying to looks like some lion. Wendy, we've had this conversation. Sorry everybody, Wendy's misbehaving again. There were some footprints on the ground. I suspect that they were lion tracks. I'm going to have another look over here. But there's quite a few raindrops over the top of them. And I don't know if you can see very well. It's very difficult. Hey, I think it's a bit... I don't know if you're going to see it properly. See there? It's so hard to see because they have had some raindrops over the top of them, unfortunately. But it looks like a lion track. So maybe we saw their tracks pretty much all over the property this morning. We're really on the move. Now, we're trying to relocate on this massive herd of elephants. It's really big. They just keep coming and coming and coming. And it seems like they could possibly pop out here around Treehouse Dam. They're just moving through the big, quite a dense block at the moment. And we're obviously not off-roading for elephants. So we may get them jump on out. I think there could be a few that have already come through. So we're just racing around, trying to get to the other side. What did you see there? Kingfishers. Where did you see kingfishers? Oh, there they are, brown hooded kingfishers, but now they're flying away. It's like when you don't see the birds, they sit there very quietly. And when you, once they've been spotted, they zoom away. Very typical of the birds. But we'll carry on going around. Let's see, I can't see any just yet. It could still be just behind them, I'm afraid. But we're going around. Look at all the, we find some nice baboon's tails that have got some flowers. Oh, you can see a few over here. And they actually all look like they're wilting away slightly. You can see a few of them. A lot of them have already wilted. These ones look like they're on their last legs. Looks like something's been munching on them. So those are the flowers of the baboon's tail, or black stick lily is another name. They're not looking as pretty as they did a few days ago when they came up. But some flowers, some life, and I suspect that we should be seeing the other flowers coming through shortly. Be nice to look out for some roadside pimpernel, some of the hibiscuses are going to come through, and of course to see the variety of morning glories. Little daisies are going to be popping out. There'll be lots of the different flowers coming through, so I can't wait to show you some of them when they do come, eventually get through, pushed through the ground. No elephants just yet, we're still looking. We can't be too far behind them. Go down here. We're just checking the perimeter of the block that they were moving through. They're very upset, and I've come to the conclusion as to why they could possibly be upset. There's quite a few of the elephants we saw coming through at the back were young bulls, but they all look to be in their 20s. And that's maybe why, maybe the females are feeling a little bit stressed as those big males are coming through and pushing and shoving the youngsters around. It can be quite boisterous, and that's the reason why they get chased out in the first place. The females didn't seem too happy with anybody this morning. And speaking of male elephants, and if you've noticed how the male elephants' tusks are much longer than those of the females. And Bobby Chair wants to know, if elephants fight, how do they fight? They use those big tusks. Okay, we're going to go down here. Do you think we'll get them down here, Vim?
Maybe.
Maybe, maybe not. So they push and shove each other with those beautiful big tusks. And often when they clash tusks, it almost sounds like a gunshot is going off. It's, you hear it from a distance. I haven't really seen a proper fight with males, seen two big males pushing each other around, but nothing too serious. I've only just seen lots of documentaries of them fighting. I want to see if I can show you. It's very far away, but there's some kudu behind me standing on, all of them standing on a termite mound looking in the distance. Let's just see if I can find that gap again. Can you see them through there? Should I go back a little bit more? They're good. You see them there? All of them on top of a termite mound, just looking in the distance just to make sure. And it's a good spot because it's quite dense in terms of how thick the lowveld can get. This is a quite a dense area, especially if there's lots of leaves. Now, instead of maybe walking through here and trying to rely on your ears when there's a bit of wind, I think it's a good idea that they do survey from a big termite mound like that. It's a great vantage point. Have you seen the elephants? Really wish I could speak to animals. They could just let me know if I'm on the right track or not. We're just bobbing and weaving along all these different roads, hoping that we're going to get a sign of where the elephants are going to pop out. Right. Nothing here just yet. I haven't seen any fresh footprints coming out, so we haven't missed them. They're still in here. Let's go over to Brent for an update.
Okay, we're not sure what's going on. Suddenly, there was this massive herd of impala in front of us, and they just bombshelled like they're wild dogs around. But I am still following Karula's tracks. So we've had the Nkuhumas already this morning. And then we checked where Karula was, but she's moved off her tracks. We're heading in this direction. And I just saw some wild dog tracks, but they looked old. But all of a sudden, these impala just scattered. There was about 40 of them in front of us. So keep your eyes open. Something else. Isn't this exciting? Remember, hashtag Safari Live, questions at wildearth.tv if you want to know anything about what's happening in the African bush. Please ask us. We love to hear from you. Also, let us know where you are. It's always wonderful to know how and where everyone is watching from. I mean, those impala were right here. They are now completely gone. They stopped. They didn't even stop. Now that makes me think, it makes me shiver with excitement. There's possibly wild dogs around. I'm trying to see if the impala stopped. They haven't stopped. They've just kept going. Wild dogs have caught me up. They're popping up behind me before. Ran that direction, so it might be something there. Even see, you see the impala, Dev? They're just gonski. Now my eyes are almost seeing wild dogs everywhere. Just a little loop down here. So there is it. Quite a strong wind today. It's cool, cold, overcast. Oh, great hunting weather if you're a predator. This is one of some of Karula's favorite sort of paths to follow, so that's why I'm checking carefully. They could just be a bit jumpy from the wind, those impala, but I don't know. They were already doing the rocking kick. Well, hopefully we'll find out shortly. James Richard wants to know, did I see any wild dog pups while I was on leave? I did, lots. I spent quite a bit of time at the wild dog den at home, and I've got some great videos that I'm still busy editing, but I will pop them up once they're finished. But yeah, I did. I was very lucky. I actually even saw a wild dog kill from my bed. It's So one morning I decided not to go on morning game drive, and I was lying there, and suddenly Nyala and Impala came storming past, and then the wild dogs killed the Impala right in front. I just had to sit up in bed, and I got to see a kill. So it was quite spectacular. But I'm going to keep checking for wild dogs and, of course, while we do that, let's go see Taylor. So I heard something. Let's just listen.
We're going to play a little game this morning, and the game is guess what flowers these are. So we'll have a look at the entire, I'm not going to tell you if it's a tree or a shrub. You can have a look, and there's lots more to give you a better idea. We'll look at a bigger one. You can see them all growing around here. So if you know what flower this is from, then you can either hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or you can even send us an email with your answers, questions@wildearth.tv. And I look forward to seeing, playing the guessing game. It's quite nice. These flowers also don't last for very long, just about a week or two, and then they disappear. So it's only a short amount of time that we get to see these lovely flowers come through, but I'm not going to give you any clues because it'll make it too easy then. I look forward to your guesses. Now, I can still hear the elephants in the distance. We can just sort of see them moving off. And they seem to have slowed their pace quite a bit. Anna Marie, give me 2 seconds. I'm going to answer your question. Because Anna Marie wants to know when the tree wisteria flowers are going to be in bloom. And I think I may have seen one, but I need to just reverse. So let's turn around here. Oh, a little bit bumpy. I'm going to go back and I'm going to see if it was indeed a tree wisteria that I was looking at. Maybe I get to show you. But typically we'll start to see the flowers now, sort of end of September, right beginning of October, even right through until November. Come on, Wendy, don't give up on us now. Now I've got to look very carefully to see if I can find this tree wisteria. I see it. So I'm looking, you see where those flowers are over there. Let's see if it is indeed. It's a bit far away, but VM is going to zoom in and then I'll be able to... Aha! Look what we've got over there. It is indeed a tree wisteria. Look at all those lovely purple flowers that are coming through. Isn't that quite nice? And it's thanks to the lovely bit of rain that we've had. I think it just gave all the trees enough water to start producing some flowers. So there we go. There is a tree wisteria for you as well, with some purple flowers. Now we're playing a game. We just saw some lovely yellow flowers. If you missed it, perhaps some of you could perhaps maybe share a screenshot that you took, just so that those who weren't watching can still have a look and participate in the game. And I look forward to hearing your answers as to who the yellow flowers belong to. Now those elephants have moved quite far in. It's really difficult to see their rumps. Oh, who do we have here? We have got a group of crested Franklins. Hello, haven't seen you for a while. You've just been hearing you. There's quite a few of them. Looks like there were 4 of them moving through here. There must be something tasty because they've been, I've been sitting around here with the elephants. I've been hearing them. What are you eating? We found some termites. They love to eat termites. It's one of their favorite things. So you always see them kicking through the dung, trying to open up some elephant dung or buffalo dung, looking for termites. But they'll eat anything, really, little beetles as well. They'll peck at seeds. They'll sort of scrape through the leaf litter like chickens. I suppose there are the bush chickens. We've got lots of different bush chickens, though, running around in the Sabi sands. And now they have disappeared. They've gone and hidden away under one of those trees that the elephants have pushed over slightly. Wendy, please stop dying on me. To give Wendy a little bit of a rev, she seems like she's taking her last legs. Oh, hang on, wait, one more bird while we're here. Is a red-billed hornbill sitting so nicely on this little tree, having a good groom on this chilly morning. Not even bothered by us at all. Normally when the hornbills realize that they've been spotted, they always fly away as the rest of the birds. But you carry on plucking yourself, just sifting through all the feathers, looking for parasites, and looking for... Oh, who have we got there? Oh, we've got a Birchall starling as well. This is a nice little area for birds. Probably a bit jealous that we weren't talking about the starling, and all our attention was focused on that hornbill. What are you looking at? They always look very angry, the Birchall starling. Oh, what did you pick up? It picked something up, perhaps some nesting material, and off it went, because it was quite big. Maybe it was a little, yeah, it looked like a stick of some sort, and now it is gone. Right, a little bit of birding, nothing wrong with that. Come on, Wendy. Oh, now you're not going anywhere. Wendy's going to have to go to the doctor's soon. Possibly it's a change in season, hot and cold. Maybe she's getting a little bit of a cold, but we'll get you sorted in no time. Right. I'm a bit disappointed in these elephants. They were moving at such a pace earlier. I thought that they were going to be racing across out into the open again, but it seems as though they're obviously quite comfortable and nice and warm in this sort of dense pocket of vegetation. And everything is nice and green. There's lots of long bits of grass for them to feed on as well, not just eat and break down all the trees. It's a nice variety for them. So I don't blame them for hanging around in here. So we were just going to bumble on and see what else we stumble into. And I hope Brent does find those wild dogs this morning. Oh, we've got some answers. Right, you've got two answers so far coming through for the questions. So Andrew says that they are yellow flowers. They are indeed yellow flowers, but what type of yellow flowers? What I was actually looking for, but good guess. And then, I've forgotten the gentleman's name. Rebecca, who is the gentleman's name? George Young. George Young says they are weeping wattle flowers. Close, but not quite. So we're still trying to guess as to what yellow flowers they are. Like I said, they only come up now at this time of the year, and then... Oh, sorry, George Yan, sorry. Oh, hang on. I just heard lots of shouting. There's a kudu in the distance. I think it was the elephants. Just want to see what they're doing and hear what they're doing. Lots of screaming was happening. Sounds like they could possibly be closer to this road that we're going to go through. I don't know if you can see any there, but there's lots of noise coming from that thick pocket. So we're going to head in that direction. There's a road just up ahead that runs to the east, and possibly we're going to find them. I think we may even see some kudu. It looks like there's quite a few kudu. So GDH, sorry, I didn't hear your answer. You said it was a monkey something. So I'm trying to listen. It's very, a monkey pod senna. That's a good guess. I haven't seen a senna in such a long time, from back from my Zambia days. But unfortunately, GDH, it's not a monkey pod senna. We're getting good guesses though. We're getting there slowly. I have no doubt that somebody is going to get this answer. Oh, we've got some kudu. We'll have to go. There's one kudu over there. So keep guessing, and I promise when someone gets the answer right, or if I eventually tell you, we'll give another two more guesses as to what that yellow flower was. And if we don't get the right answer, then I will tell you about that particular tree that we were looking at. You see, everybody's very unhappy. Everyone's very fluffed up. The antelope don't have their lovely shiny coats like they normally do. Looks like this one hasn't had a brush yet, but that's just because fluffing their hair up keeps them nice and warm. There's a little family of kudu. I suspect this is the same group of kudu that was standing on the termite mound surveying the area. Perhaps the elephants have chased them out a little bit because they're sounding very angry. There's another one just behind the termite mound, munching away on all the new green leaves that are coming through. VM also says that it's very cold this morning and he's looking forward to a nice cup of coffee, which I'm apparently making for him. Come on, Wendy, you can do it. So let's see. We're just driving around and around this block and it's quite nice. You drive around it once and you miss something and you go around again and flowers start to pop out. Elephants, where are you? Because you are now tormenting me by just shouting and screaming in an area where I cannot see them anymore. We'll give it one last go, and if we don't come right there, then we're going to move away. We're going to leave the elephants. They obviously don't want to be seen by us anymore. Perhaps they are sick of me. Right. So remember, we're going to do two more chances at guessing what flowers that I showed you, those yellow flowers. And while you ponder as to what the answer could be, let's go have a chat with Brent.
Now, my head is in quite a common position, I'm sure our long-time viewers are used to me being in, which is hanging half out of the car, searching for footprints. Now, the last tracks, actually, of Krula, we can actually directly through there, where her tracks were, heading straight in this direction, and I haven't found any coming out. So we've gone back, slowly making our way towards those last tracks, at the same time scouring the landscape. Now, of course, this is live and non-scripted, so what happens, happens. So when I flick Dave, he goes, ah, and it's real. But remember, hashtag Safari Live or on Twitter or questions at wildearth.tv on email if you ask us any questions. Now, I'm quite fascinated to what yellow flower Taylor has got, but I think I have some suspicions to what yellow flowers are out and about. I think Queen Karula might have headed to one of her favorite spots, where I found her reclining many times. If we don't find any tracks here, I might take a little stroll into that area. But so far, no tracks coming out. There is always the possibility she's crossed on some hard ground. I think she might be having a snooze in this little river system on the western edge of quarantine. Now, I think we're going to start seeing, I'm going to call it in about 3 days, 4 days, let's say 4 days. We should start seeing some of the anthericum flowers and other wonderful flowers start popping out. These are lion tracks, those are definitely not Karula tracks. Male lion tracks, they're a bit old. I think you can get them there, Dave. Yeah, so they're a bit old, you can see. Not very defined, the wind has ruffled them a bit. It's a bit big for Queen Karula, that one. Let's double check. Always double check where we've got game parts coming out. Another thing we're going to check for here is this is that area that herd of impala disappeared into. Now there is always the chance that Karula is stuck down that river system and headed towards Chelepan. I might meander there, although I think Taylor's in the area, I might give her a call. And see if she, just tell her to have a quick check around Chelepan. Taylor. Kata, if you're on Twin Dams, just have a careful look around Chelepan and that little drainage system that runs past there. There's a possibility Krula has kept down that drainage. I don't know, missed the tracks on the hard ground at Philemon's dip. Copy, thanks. I still got the sneaking suspicion she's snoozing somewhere. Uncle Tomorrow, Siberia, Zumi. And Siberia is wondering, with all the flowers starting to come up, when are the moths and butterflies? I nearly said moths and butterflies. when are they going to come out? They're already out, but on this cold, windy weather, we're not going to see too many of them. But I will be keeping an eye out for them, don't you worry. Okay, so no sign on Rebecca's Road. So I think let's check Zoe's next. Now, some impala. I'm just trying to see if they're relaxed or skittish. No, not too skittish. They're always going to be a bit jumpy in this windy weather. Let's carry on. Now, Lucy's wondering, do we get the mother of pearl butterfly in this area? I'm not 100% sure, Lucy. So the problem with butterflies, a lot of their common names vary massively, even regionally in a country. So that's quite often that the scientific names work best, but I will try find out. Or if you can let me know the mother of pearl's scientific name, I probably will be able to give you a better answer. Okay, so no tracks coming out here, and someone's already trekked this area. So I'm going to go make my way slowly back towards the last set of tracks and see if maybe she's not hanging around one of her favorite jackalberry trees. Lots of impala around. I'm going to scoot past them. They're looking very relaxed. There we go. You can see they are a little bit jumpy with the wind, but they're not looking like there's a wild dog. Oh, nice bird. Okay, come out, Dave. On the ground, literally. There we go. Oh, there he goes. There he goes. There you go. You see where he landed? I didn't. A little bee eater. Oh, is that in there? No, that is a leaf. Let's move forward a skosh. It's ridden the wind out of sight, unfortunately. Oh, we've got a male impala with a broken horn. Oh, he's off. There he is. Now that would have been from fighting. Lucky for him, it broke quite high up. So I don't think too much pain or blood or chance of infection there. Standing by.
Okay, copy, thanks. I'm going to go around and I'll check from Gary Main's side, make sure she hasn't crossed out. Okay, so it looks like Taylor might have found the tracks crossing below or above where we crossed. So where we turned off, they were closer towards the end of Philemon's. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to turn around and head back in that direction. So while we turn around, head back to give Taylor a hand, let's go back to Taylor and see how her tracking is going.
So we've also found some leopard tracks, which is quite exciting. Now I know it's now just a matter of time, but we're going to check Shabam Road and just see if she maybe went through this block. Though the tracks that I found, they're very, very hard to sort of tell that it was leopard, and purely because again she moved. Let's see, we've got a bird in a tree. But sorry, as I was saying, it looks like she moved during the rain. Her tracks have got a bit of rain on them, so we're just trying to align. Is that right, or a bit forward? There. Let's see who we've got eating here. It does indeed look like an African hairy hawk, is it? It's so hard to see with the colouring. Look at us. It looks brown, though. Maybe it's another eagle. I can't see 100% properly. It's the most bizarre thing. I'm going to try and take a photo and see if I can zoom in on it, just because it's quite grey, but it looks like it's got the facial skin. And you are actually too far for my lens. Just trying to have a look, everybody. And eating a snake, which is quite amazing. Yeah, look how cool that is. It actually looks like it's a Wahlberg's eagle. It looks fairly small. And it was quite tricky, though, from a distance. We saw that yellow facial skin, and it did indeed look like it was a African harrier hawk. However, I think this is... maybe it's a juvenile. I just want to quickly double check something while you have a look. Possibly maybe a juvenile. Its behavior is very much like a gymnogene, an African harrier hawk. Let me just double check. Let's go to harrier hawks. Awesome that it got a little meal, and unusual that it got a snake as well. It's quite chilly. We're not seeing the snakes doing too much moving around. Yes, it actually could be a juvenile because it's got a very large white-yellow facial skin going around its eye. Sort of a little bit more than what we normally see. Yeah, so I think it is indeed a juvenile African harrier hawk. It's quite difficult to tell the difference between all the juveniles. All the different species of juveniles are usually always brown. So it's quite tricky, but I'm going to go with that. And I don't know what snake it's eating, I'm afraid. Didn't look like a particularly big one. I wonder if it fished it out of perhaps the bark of the tree. Maybe it was just keeping warm around there. Or it could have maybe even got it from a burrow.